Shalom, fellow Rastafari. This is Wendy Malonzo, and we bring forth this reasoning on behalf of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society. And this is, in fact, concerning Gaza and the Queen of the South, Queen Makeda of Ethiopia, the Queen of the Lands of Sheba. And if we could just direct ourselves to Proverbs. More specifically, Proverbs of Solomon. Well, actually, this one is chapter 25. It reads, "Warnings and instructions continued." And verse 1 would actually read, "These are also the Proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out." Now, just really briefly, it is well necessary that we make mention that Hezekiah is actually of Ethiopian descent. And we bring forth that claim because it is necessary to establish some of these well-known and clear and obvious facts that we as Rastafari, true and faithful, are aware of, but the rest of the world seems to either ignore it, pretend it's not there, or assume otherwise. And so it is only for those that to this very day have not had ears to hear, eyes to see, so that and are actually willing to make their wills obedient to good influences and refuse all evil, that they too may be able to share in the wealth that is truth, and know the scriptures and know them for the truth that they are, and not for what many have pretended to be, you know. And so it's necessary that we bring forth these evidences for those that are kind of like borderline towards accepting truth for what it is, or otherwise continue in their you know, well, confused ways. So we make mention Hezekiah and our claim that Hezekiah is at least, if not exactly Ethiopian, at least somehow associated with the land of Ethiopia, either born in the land or a direct descendant of an actual Ethiopian. And we actually reference Zephaniah, the book of the prophet Zephaniah, to kind of establish that. And if we would, I guess, excuse me, this is kind of like, we're kind of being diverted to another direction, but still, we feel it necessary, being that the world refuses to accept the role and responsibility of Ethiopia in scriptures, and quite significant is the role of Ethiopia and Ethiopians in Bible scripture. And so we feel it necessary to just make mention of these important details. Excuse me, we're actually having a somewhat of a difficult time finding Zephaniah. We apologize for that. And so can't seem to get this page. So now Zephaniah chapter 1 verse 1 reads, "The word of the Lord which came to Zephaniah, the son of Cushi." So now Cushi, Hebraically, is exactly the word Cush, meaning Ethiopian. Thus, we conclude that Zephaniah at least descends from an Ethiopian. Now Cushi, the son of Gedaliah, the son of Amariah, the son of Hezekiah. Now, many would assume that is in fact of no significance, but here's our point. Other than the fact that this individual Cushi was either born in the land of Ethiopia or is directly associated to Ethiopians, in the sense of either of that stock of people, race of people, some would say, or of that genealogy. Other than that, we honestly don't see any other way or reason why other types of individual or other types of tribesmen or peoples would name their children exactly that, Cush or Cushi or Ethiopian, if not in fact completely or directly related to either the people or the land. And another I guess like side note would be the fact that we've noticed a trend in which Nimrod is oftentimes portrayed as an evil character, a wicked identity. And we've noticed that whenever Nimrod is mentioned, really quickly people are really quick to make that connection and connect Nimrod to Cush. For instance, an example would be people would say, "Oh yeah, Nimrod wanted to take over the world." Nimrod, the relative of Cush, a descendant of Cush, really quickly make that connection as if saying, "Oh yeah, the bad guy, descendant of a black man." Basically, I mean, we're not saying that they do this consciously, but in many different teachings and lectures and presentations, we've noticed that individuals are quick to make that link between Nimrod and Cush, and we've also noticed that being that connection is possible, many individuals don't like to be associated with Cush. And so we don't oftentimes see Ashkenazi Jews or white Caucasian Jews that say they are, but most are not, and we don't speak of those true and faithful. We're not generalizing, if in spirit and truth they seek to do what is true, then in fact they are of Judah. But basically, let's not get into those whole complications. What we're trying to say is that you won't find too many Caucasian individuals naming their children Cush, when all, what not all right, but when many have oftentimes pretended and associated Cush, Ethiopia with those that have been cursed, with those that have committed evil, with those associated Cush with anything that is of a ne negative aspect. And so basically, we just had to make mention of that because we know that the wicked like to twist things and pretend things are when in fact they are not. And they'll use these little, they'll say something like, "Well, anyone could be named Cush, But we already went into details as to how that is not exactly the case, So we're just trying to defend. We're trying to close all gaps and not leave any breathing space for these wicked that like to just change their attitudes and their arguments to satisfy the topic or the conversation that is at hand. And so, continuing, now our main focus was to make mention that it is the glory. This is the second verse of the 25th Proverbs of Solomon, which was copied by Hezekiah, as we have stated, an Ethiopian. Now, it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter. And scripture indicates if we seek him, we shall find him. And so we must study and show unto thyself approved to be men, not ashamed of the word of truth, rightfully dividing the word of truth. So let's go on forward and do as previously stated. Now, we personally accept this second verse of the 25th Proverbs to be a direct reference to the Kebra Negesht, which is the glory, the honor of kings. And so that is exactly, in fact, what the Kebra Negesht it does. It seeks out the glory of kings, the honor of kings, and it searches out a matter. And so that is exactly what we too are to do. Now, if we would grab a copy of the Queen of Sheba and her only son Menelik, which is the Lion of Judah Society's publication of the Kevra Negesht, if we were to go on forward to page 40, we found it really interesting that it the lower chapter or paragraph in this page 40 of the Kevra Negesht, the Queen of Sheba and her only son Menelik, read, "And the young man," and this is speaking of Menelik, Dawit the second, Huletenya, we think it would be said in Beamarenya, but nonetheless, the young man, referring to Menelik and his retinue, so his whole company made straight their way, and they journeyed on and came into the country of the neighborhood of Gaza. Now this is the Gaza which Solomon the king gave to the queen of Ethiopia. Excuse me. Gaza, which Solomon the king gave to the queen of Ethiopia. And in the Acts of the Apostles, Luke the Evangelist wrote, saying, he was the governor of the whole country of Gaza, and eunuch of Queen Handike, who had believed on the word of Luke the Apostle. And it gives us one reference, and it is to Acts chapter 8, verse 27. Now, at first, being that we are somewhat familiar with Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, we've read it and studied it previously. It didn't sound all that exact what Isaac, the writer of the Kebra Negesh, was in fact stating here. But in our hearts, we had faith that Isaac was not mistaken in the words that he published in the Kebra Negesh, and so, or publicated more correctly. And so all we had to do was seek out a matter, to seek that which God had concealed. And being that the Old Testament is like a reflection of those things concealed, well, the New Testament, the living word, which is I and I in Jesus Christos, Yeshua HaMashiach, in fact, those things become revealed. It is only to those who seek out the matter, search out the matter. And so that is exactly what we did, and we had faith that Isaac was not mistaken in this statement. So naturally, we directed ourselves over to Acts of the Apostles, and we opened up the Blue Letter Bible Dictionary, or not sure if that's what it's called, but it's the Blue Letter Online. It's a reference Bible. And so let us begin from verse 27, as referenced in the Kebra Negesh. And he arose and went. This is Philip. It's speaking on behalf of Philip. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candike, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all of her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem, for to worship. Now, eunuch, we must define eunuch. Eunuch could be defined as a superintendent of a certain chamber, a bed keeper, a bed guard, a superintendent of women's apartments, one with the hold, or that has the oversight of a treasury. So basically, it's referring to and a court official authorized to protect or to keep a certain lodging place of a we could say of a female royal personnel, or that of a woman with royal status. He's like he's protecting a bed, we could say, does not necessarily have to mean, well, bed in the sense that a place of rest, a place of where one has shelter, a locale, we could say. And on the forward, because we don't know why, but we've heard many cases of people trying to say that a eunuch is someone without a penis. I mean, as weird as that sounds, they oftentimes make mention that eunuchs had their penises cut off, and then it's like the Gentile world, individuals within the Gentile mentality, like if they did not have the power to keep from laying with a woman without having their penises cut off. It's like we as men, with reasoning and understanding and intelligence, we could control our so-called like natural tendencies, and not have to cut our penises off to keep us from laying with a female. So I mean, that's kind of off. It's not off topic, but for some reason, a lot of we've heard this, and we just want to like completely discredit that, because a real man can handle himself and doesn't necessarily have to have his penis cut off to prevent him from laying with a woman. So that's that. Okay, continuing. So basically, Kandeke, which is not really her name. It's more of a title, and might as well put it out there. It's defined as princess or prince of servants, which is well significant. But we'll make mention of that a little bit later. So on the forward, better yet. So Queen Kandike, Queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge. Now the charge, it's referring to like the charge, but of a place, of a like upon the earth, had the charge of a place upon the earth. It's exactly what the blue letter Bible indicated, of all her treasure. Now treasure is the key word. Treasure, if we look up that word in the blue letter Bible, it is in fact, it gives us the reference of G1047. G1047, and the word is Gaza. It's a royal treasury. It's a tr it's defined as a royal treasury, treasure, riches, and even, well, stronghold, we could even say. And so basically, this eunuch, this bedkeeper, was in charge of all of the place upon the earth of Gaza. That he was the governor of Gaza for the prince of servants, which is the queen of the Ethiopians. So basically, Isaac, in all sincerity, in all truth and actuality, Isaac, the writer, the publicator of the Kebra Negesht, was not mistaken when he made mention that Solomon had given to the queen of Ethiopia all the country of Gaza. That's in fact what is being stated here accurately in Acts of the Apostles chapter 8. And thus we can conclude, we fast Tefari already knew this, but sometimes it makes our faith that much stronger to just seek out a matter and really know it in its fullness, in its completeness. It makes it that much glorious. So with that, now let's kind of seek into the matter of Kandike or Handike, which would be the Mitzvah Kedus word for Kandike. It's more of a Handike. So prince or princes of servants. Honestly, this is an assumption, but we feel it to be true. Princes in the sense that because queens were not necessarily known to rule empires. We're thinking that prince is referencing to the female queen in the sense that without a king, there's no real legitimate there's not really a legitimate imperial house in a sense. And so prince of servants, we accept it to be referencing the queen of servants. Now servants, if we were to go on to Jeremiah chapter 37, we have Ebed Melech, the Ethiopian, one of the eunuchs in the king's court. So Ebed Melech being servant of kings. So we have another eunuch that is a servant of the king, and that and so we clearly can conclude that is in fact what is taking place. Queen of the Ethiopians, because of Jeremiah chapter 37 and Ebed Melech, the Ethiopian, one of the eunuchs in the king's court, we can conclude that Kandike or Handike is in fact referencing the queen of Ethiopia as the queen of the servants, as proven in chapter 37 of the book of Jeremiah. And if that is so significant that we would direct ourselves to that. So give we just 1 second to actually go to Jeremiah. Now we'll begin from chapter 36 and give like a brief summary. It is in fact it is the fourth year of Jehoiakim the son of Josiah, the king of Judah, that, and it's referring to the word that came to Jeremiah, saying, take thee a roll of a book and write therein all the words that I have spoken against Israel, against Judah, and against all the nations. And so Jeremiah calls forth for Baruch the scribe to write down the words in a roll, in a scroll, and eventually Baruch reads the words in the ears of the people. Some of the princes find out, the princes call for Jehudi, which is necessary to make mention that Jehudi is the son of Nethaniah, which is the son of Shelemiah, which is the son of Cushi. So now we have Jehudi, one of the princes of the king's court, of the king of Judah, Josiah. Or okay, we may have made a little mistake there, but nonetheless, one of the princes, Jehudi, is to a direct descendant of Cushi, whether it be son or son-in-law, but nonetheless, related to an Ethiopian, to a Cushite. And so they call for Jehudi, the princes call for Jehudi to go forth to Baruch so that Baruch read the same words that he read to the people in the ears of the princes. Now the princes don't like what they hear because, like today, they want profiting that profits them nothing. They want vanity, and they want to hear nice, sweet things that make them feel good. And so, long story short, what ends up happening is that they imprison Jeremiah. Now, the only individual that stands up and pleads the cause of Jeremiah and risks his life and actually goes up to the king at that time, appointed, and pleads for the rescue of Jeremiah is in fact the Ebed-Melech. So now if we could read chapter 38 of the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Excuse me, we said chapter 37 earlier. It's in fact chapter 38 that references Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian. So now it's verse 7 reads, now when Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian, one of the eunuchs which was in the king's house, heard that they had put Jeremiah in the dungeon, the king then sitting in the excuse me, in the gate of Benjamin, Ebed-Melech went forth out of the king's house and spake to the king, saying, my lord the king, these men have done evil in all that they have done to Jeremiah the prophet, whom they have cast into the dungeon, and he is like to die for hunger in the place where he is, for there is no more bread in the city. Then the king commanded Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian, saying, take from hence 30 men with thee, and take up Jeremiah the prophet out of the dungeon before he die. So Ebed-Melech, it took the men with him and went into the house of the king under the treasury. So even that's interesting, and took thence old. So basically, I don't want to bore the eye them with reading, but Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian said to Jeremiah, put now these old cats. So basically they rescue him. Ebed-Melech rescues Jeremiah. Now he's not necessarily out of prison, he's still in the prison court, but now at least he's not in the hole. Basically he's not in the dungeon. So in chapter 39 we have verse 16, and it reads, go speak, this is the word, the commandment sent to Jeremiah by the Lord. And it reads, go and speak to Ebed-Melech the Ethiopian, saying, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring my words upon this city for evil and not for good, and they shall be accomplished in that day before thee. But I will deliver thee in that day, saith the Lord, and thou shalt not be given into the hand of the men whom thou art afraid. For I will surely deliver thee, and thou shalt not fall by the sword, but thy life shall be for a prey to thee, because thou hast put thy trust in me, saith the Lord. Blessed be the man that trusted in the Lord. It is oftentimes mentioned in Scripture. So, just to connect the role and the significance of Kandake, cave prince of the servants, and now we have the servant of the king, the Ethiopian, one of the eunuchs in the king's house, and in the gate of Benjamin. I mean, there's so many connections. We could go to Psalm 7, and we know that those were a psalm of praise that of David to the Lord concerning the words of Cush. Now, if that's Psalm 7, and if we were to reference even Habakkuk, we have in Habakkuk, in the third chapter, we have let us actually go there. Just 1 second, please. Okay, so Habakkuk. If we read verse 3, it reads, God came from Tamim, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. Paran is actually the pronunciation for that is Peri, and somehow we find it to be similar to Ferry and Ras Teferi and first fruits and all that, but and the first seeds or out of the head of the seed, out of the seed, out of the head, first fruits out of the head. That whole connection is interesting right there, but nonetheless, from Mount Paran, Selah, his glory covered the heavens, and the earth was full of his praise. So basically, God came from Tamim. Tamim is in fact it's defined as south quarter, and eventually the root word for that is Yamin or Yaman actually, which is right hand, right quarter, south side, south quarter. And so basically what we're trying to make mention is that in one of the root words it gives a sense of that it's oftentimes female, but in this case male, and we like to kind of like connect that with Handeke, the queen of the south, and her right hand, her bedkeeper. And so like you'll see the Son of Man on the right hand of glory, we think it says. But anyways, there's so many different connections. Basically, we know that God did come from the south, and even we have Yemen as a as kind of like a testimony as to how relative that is to the lands of Ethiopia, Tamim and Yamin. And then interestingly enough, we have also Tamrin, which was the right hand of Queen Makeda of Ethiopia, her merchant man that went to travel to Jerusalem and brought back all that knowledge concerning Solomon, which initiated that spark to make Makeda want to seek out that name of the one true and living God that Solomon knew about. And so all of these things are so interesting, but let us make one other connection, which is extremely important and necessary. If we were to reference 2 Samuel, the 7th chapter, we could even say Sebat, Me'irah Sebat, which would be chapter 7 in the Be Amarenya in Amharic. Even that's interesting. That's a little, I guess, like last minute footnote that we can't even include. But as we find our ways to 2 Samuel, we're looking for Me'irath Sebat. And so more specifically, we're looking for verse 23. And it reads, "And what one nation in the earth is like thy people, even like Israel, whom God went to redeem for a people to himself, and to make him a name, and to do for you great things and terrible for thy land before thy people, which thou redeemest to thee from Egypt, from the nations and their gods?" Question mark. That was so interesting, because if we were to go to Amos, and we were actually reading 2 Samuel last night, and we came across that verse, and it just automatically tied into like a whole lot of other stuff that we were thinking on presenting. But let us find Amos. I'm sure many already know what verse it is that we're actually seeking to obtain, but nonetheless, it is necessary that we go to it and just know truth for what it is and not for what many would like for it to be. And we seem to if you could, okay, Amos, and we're looking for chapter 9 verse 7, no doubt. And it reads, "Are ye not as children of the Ethiopians to me, O children of Israel?" said the Lord. "Have not I brought up Israel out of the land of Egypt?" So basically, to that question in 2 Samuel's Me'irav Sebat, basically, chapter 7, verse 23. What one nation in the earth is like thy people? Well, Amos 9 and 7 gives us the answers. Are ye not as children of the Ethiopians to me? So what one nation is in the earth is like his people? And that is Ethiopia, without any reasonable doubt. So, and might as well go a little bit forward, and just to shine some light on the Quebranagesht and its authenticity, its authority in Jesus Christos, its actuality, its reality, and its credibility. Let us just give one more reference, and that'll be First Kings chapter 10. We personally think it's beautiful how scripture itself just makes everything well clear. All we have to do is seek out a matter. So chapter 10, and key here is, and when the queen of Sheba, first of all, queen is actually referencing of royalty. So not, there's many queens, but this one is specifically the queen of Sheba is referring to of royal blood. So the queen of royal blood of Sheba heard the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord. So that was what she was after. Not riches, not anything else, but after the name of the Lord. And she came to prove him, to try him, Try every spirit, says John. And he that claims that Jesus Christos came in his Ethiopian flesh, he is of God. And so now the verse we're trying to get to is verse 13, and it reads, "And King Solomon gave to the Queen of Sheba all her desire." She desired the name of the Lord. "What is his name and what is his son's name, if thou canst tell?" says one of the proverbs. None the least. So King Solomon gave to the Queen of Sheba all her desire, whatsoever she asked, beside that which Solomon gave her of his royal bounty. Now, royal bounty would be, royal would be Malek or Malek, kingly, and bounty, the word for bounty, interestingly enough, King James Version Bible decided to go with the word bounty, but in fact, the Hebraic word behind that in the actual scriptures is Yad. So besides all that Queen Maked of Ethiopia of Sheba asked for, beside that which Solomon also gave her his royal hand. Now, and we kind of then she turned and went to her own country, she and her servants. So can this be any more clear? Her servant, she's the prince, the queen of servants. We know who the servants of the Most High God Jireh, the far I are. Excuse me, we know who the servants of the Most High God Jireh, the far I are, and those are in fact that one nation that is like to Israel upon the earth, which is Ethiopia. And so it's pretty well clear. And so she goes back to her own country. But the key word here is bounty. It's yod, it's hand. It's up to ones to kind of figure out if that means that he gave her his royal hand in marriage. And that's in fact why we looked this up, because in the Spanish Bible it actually says that tomó de mano, took of hand, or took by the hand, or took her hand, or something like that. And so that really initiated a kind of like a search concerning royal bounty, and surely enough, King Solomon of Jerusalem gave his royal hand of wed to wed maybe. The Queen Maked of Ethiopia. Well, not maybe, we know it's a fact, due to the glory of kings, the honor of kings, the scriptures that's much needed to kind of like figure out the matter, those things concealed, now revealed in Jesus Christos. And all thanks be to our father, Kedemawi Haile Selassie, elect of God, conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, king of kings of Ethiopia. So with that, we give thanks to all Rastafari. You know, shalom.